Hey, how's it going, everyone? I'm White Pointer, and as you may be aware, I've spent the past few videos directly answering some viewer questions about how classic games achieved their end results. I was recently discussing the topic with my family, who had their own question. How did the real-time clock work in the Generation 2 Pokemon games, Pokemon Gold, Silver, and Crystal, and how did it keep the time even when the system was turned off? That was a great question. In order to answer that, we'll need to cover some background information first, so it's a good excuse to do a deep dive into some Game Boy tech that's not actually discussed too often. So, let's do it! Early Game Boy cartridges, such as Tetris, were pretty simple. They just had one chip that contained the ROM data, and that was it. They had no ability to save, and the maximum size of the ROM was pretty small. In fact, the biggest ROM size the Game Boy could effectively access was just 32 kilobytes, which isn't much, even when you're talking about its low-resolution monochrome display. So it wasn't long until games started to include an extra integrated circuit on the cartridge, called a memory bank controller or MBC chip, often referred to as a mapper chip. In fact, Super Mario Land, a launch title for the platform, incorporated such a chip, so they were being used from day one. What these did was exactly what their name suggests. They allowed the Game Boy to access larger ROM sizes by utilizing bank switching. This is a concept that I covered in my video about how the Neo Geo worked, because that heavily used it, but it wasn't all that common on home consoles at the time. But as unusual as it may seem, the Game Boy of all platforms extensively made use of it as well. In fact, the vast majority of games released for it included some kind of mapper chip. If you didn't see that Neo Geo video, what bank switching basically is, in simplest terms, is a way for developers to use more memory than a processor would normally allow. Processors can only address a certain amount of memory, so they would split the data into banks and switch what bank was currently loaded into memory as needed. What this did was allow much larger games than would normally be possible. In the case of the Game Boy, these MBC chips allowed it to do just that. The game ROM was split into a series of 16 kilobyte banks, and the mapper chip would swap which of those banks was currently being read from the ROM on the fly, as many times as needed. This allowed much larger ROM sizes than the 32 kilobytes that was originally possible, initially up to 2 megabytes, and ultimately reaching up to 8 megabytes. Eventually, games like Metroid 2 started including RAM chips, usually in the form of SRAM or static RAM, which were most often used to save game data. But because RAM is only temporary, games that were able to save included a battery in the cartridge that gave the RAM just enough power to retain that data while the game was off. It was also occasionally used to actually provide extra memory if the 8 kilobytes of onboard RAM the Game Boy had wasn't quite enough. Some games, like the Pokemon games, used it for both of these functions. Games that utilized the extra RAM also accessed it through the memory bank controller, with chips being able to access up to 32 kilobytes of RAM initially, and eventually being able to access up to 128 kilobytes of RAM. Games that included a battery back to save function had an additional small chip on the PCB, often referred to as a supervisor, reset, or RAM protector chip, which controlled whether the SRAM was powered by the Game Boy if the game was being played, or the battery if it wasn't. There were a number of different memory bank controller chips, some of which included some additional functions. MBC1, or a variation of it, was the most common, providing a maximum of 32 kilobytes of RAM and allowing ROM sizes up to 2 megabytes. MBC2 existed, but was basically a cheaper, stripped-down version if the developers didn't need all the features of MBC1, but wasn't used very much. This was basically it until 1997, when we saw the introduction of the MBC3 chip, with the Gen 1 Pokemon games being some of the earliest usages of it. And this chip also had a number of revisions. The MBC3 supported the same maximum ROM size of the MBC1 at 2 megabytes, but doubled the maximum RAM to 64 kilobytes. But also, importantly for this discussion, it included an integrated real-time clock or RTC chip inside it. The Gen 1 Pokemon games didn't make use of the RTC chip inside the MBC3, but the Gen 2 games, Gold, Silver, and Crystal, all did. Using this functionality, the game had a day-night cycle that corresponded in real time to the real world, even when the game was switched off, as the internal battery kept it going. Of course, this also meant that the battery drained a lot quicker than most other games, and since the same battery was used for retaining save data, it meant that those would be lost too once the battery was dead. As a result, these games are some of the most common to need battery replacements, whereas many other older games might still be rocking their original batteries after all this time with no problems. The real-time clock didn't just magically operate on its own, however, it needed some help. So here's the PCBs of a Gen 1 Pokemon game and a Gen 2 Pokemon game side by side. Can you spot the difference? It's up there in the top left portion of the board. What is that thing under the tape and what does it do? That's a crystal oscillator, clocked at a speed of 32.768 kHz, which controls the real-time clock circuit inside the MBC3 chip and keeps it going at the exact speed that it needs to. What's actually interesting is that if you look at the boards of the two games next to each other like this, you can see that the Gen 1 games actually have a spot on the board for the oscillator, labelled X1, but it's not actually used. When you start a new game of Pokemon Gold, Silver or Crystal, the first thing it does is ask you what time it is. You set the clock to whatever your local time is, and the in-game clock will reflect that with its day-night cycles, managed by the Crystal Oscillator, controlling the real-time clock chip that continues tracking the time even with the game turned off with the battery powering it. An odd quirk of the RTC though was that it could only track a maximum of 511 days when powered by the battery, due to how it's stored in the RAM. But as long as you power on the game at least once in that period, it knows to reset it and then it'll track another 511 days and the cycle can be repeated forever. Or at least until the battery goes flat. Pokemon Crystal only needed 32 kilobytes of RAM, except for the Japanese version, which used the whole 64 kilobytes the chip could support. The reason it needed that extra RAM was apparently for its online features through Mobile System GB, which was accessed with the Mobile Game Boy Adapter peripheral that was only available in Japan and therefore removed from the international release. It used a revision of the MBC3 chip called the MBC30 and is the only known game to do so. It's also worth noting that unlike Gold and Silver, which were Game Boy Color games that were backwards compatible with the original DMG hardware, Crystal only worked with the Game Boy Color. The MBC3 chip, or one of its variants, the MBC3A or MBC3B, was used in a large number of games, though most of them didn't utilize its RTC capabilities. I was unable to track down exactly what the differences are between the original MBC3, MBC3A and MBC3B, with any sources I found, such as this article I'll link in the description, only theorizing that each revision must have just been to fix bugs in the hardware, due to Nintendo ceasing manufacture of the older revision once the newer one was available. There doesn't appear to be any performance difference between them. If you have any other theories on what the differences are between these variations, let me know in the comments. Most games that use one of these chips seem to have enhancements for the Game Boy Color, Super Game Boy, or both. The Game Boy Color launched in 1998, and most developers transitioned over to that, which obviously also supported the Game Boy's memory bank controllers to maintain full backwards compatibility. This was when Nintendo also introduced a new mapper chip, the MBC5. Yeah, they skipped the MBC4 for some reason, possibly because the number 4 is considered unlucky in Japanese culture, but I guess we'll never know for sure. It was used in a few backwards compatible Game Boy games, but for the most part was used for GBC exclusives. It could map up to 8 megabytes of ROM, 4 times out of the MBC3, and 128 kilobytes of RAM, double the MB3C's maximum. It was unique in that it had support to control a rumble motor, such as the one found in Pokemon Pinball. The rumble control was pretty basic, as it was essentially a Boolean value that set the rumble to be either on or off, with no kind of intensity setting being available. Once it was on, it stayed on until it was turned off. However, the rumble could still be made to feel like it had different strengths, based on how long it was active. For a weaker rumble, it would only be enabled for short bursts and be repeatedly turned on and off, whereas keeping it enabled for longer would result in a stronger rumble. Again, I'll leave a link in the description where you can read up some more about this. Nintendo went on to manufacture two more mappers, the MBC6, used by only one game to handle downloading data onto a flash memory chip, and MBC7, which was similar to the MBC5, but included a two-axis accelerometer for motion controls, with Kirby's Tilt and Tumble being one of only two games that used it. The last mapper chip Nintendo manufactured is sometimes referred to as a metamapper, the MMM01. This chip was specifically used for some multi-game cartridges, providing a boot menu that allowed you to select a game before emulating the NBC1 chip for the selected game. No commercial collection that used this chip contained more than 4 games, even though it was capable of accommodating more than that. The NBC5 became the standard chip used in the vast majority of Game Boy Color games, but the NBC3 was never truly phased out and was still showing up in games right up until the end of the platform's lifespan, when Nintendo finally transitioned over to the Game Boy Advance. Probably because some developers didn't need all the extra features provided by the NBC5, so the cheaper NBC3 was enough to get the job done. There were also a couple of chips designed and manufactured by third parties and officially licensed by Nintendo. Bandai made one called the Tama 5 to use in just one Japanese-only Tamagotchi game. I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing in this game, but whatever I'm doing seems to be working.
I have no idea what I'm doing, but I know I'm doing it really, really well.
Amongst some other things, like a piezoelectric buzzer, this game also included a real-time clock that had its speed set by a crystal oscillator. Although in this case, the RTC was actually a separate chip, which was controlled by the Tama 5. Something that's pretty interesting about this title is that Bandai, unlike Nintendo, seemed to acknowledge the battery problem, because they built an easily removable battery cover into the case, allowing the battery to be changed quickly without needing to open up the entire thing. The other unusual aspect about this cartridge is that it had its own custom ROM chip, called the Tama 7, and a custom microcontroller called the Tama 6. Hudson Soft also made their own mappers, two of them actually, to use in their own games they developed. Oddly enough, one of these was another Pokemon game, in this case the Japanese version of the Pokemon trading card game, which used the first iteration of the chip called the HUC-1. This was because these mappers included an infrared sensor, so the game, which was a backwards compatible Game Boy Color game, could still communicate on the monochrome Game Boy models. The international version, though, swapped out the HUC-1 to use the NBC-5 instead, with the communication function just handled by the GBC's IR port, meaning this feature was unavailable on the older DMG hardware. Hudson Soft made an updated version called the HUC-3 that expanded its capabilities to include a piezoelectric buzzer and a real-time clock, similar to the Tama 5. Also, like Bandai, knowing that the extra battery drain would be a problem, they likewise built a removable battery cover into the cartridge housing for games that use this chip for easy access to replace the battery. Neither the HUC-1 nor the HUC-3 was used outside of Japan. So, that's how the real-time clock in the Pokemon games worked, which turned into more of a deep dive into the Game Boy's mapper chips, with a few other random facts about Pokemon games thrown in, but I hope it was an interesting exploration and you learned something. As usual, I'll leave some links in the description for you to check out if you want to go down the rabbit hole and investigate more about this yourself. Give me a thumbs up if you like this video, it really helps a lot, and don't forget to subscribe to stay up to date with my content. Thanks for watching, and see you next time!